of Commerce.
We need to make more of these on our shores in the United States so that we can not only create jobs, but also protect our people.
Then, America Addicted. New data reveals a dramatic spike in overdose deaths among people of color during the first year of the pandemic. And after Roe, doctors in red states worry that abortion laws could hinder their ability to treat patients in life or death situations. All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by...
For 25 years, Consumer Cellular has been offering no-contract wireless plans designed to help people do more of what they like. Our U.S.-based customer service team can help find a plan that fits you. To learn more, visit consumercellular.tv.
And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions, and friends of the NewsHour, including Kathy and Paul Anderson, and Camilla and George Smith.
The John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, fostering informed and engaged communities. More at kf.org.
This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
I'm Stephanie Tsai with NewsHour West. We'll return to the full program after the latest headlines. Today was the hottest day ever recorded in Britain. The country baked under superheated air that sparked fires and buckled train tracks. It is part of a wider weather emergency in Europe that's lasted for days.
A scorching heat wave continues to engulf Europe, smashing high temperature records. In the UK Tuesday, the mercury hit 104.5 degrees, beating a record set in 2019. As the heat wave moved north to Germany, residents sought ways to stay cool.
Up until the early afternoon, the pool's quite pleasant, especially with small kids. But once it gets too hot, we're going home.
But most homes in Europe don't have air conditioning, which makes the heat more dangerous. Officials have tallied more than 1,000 heat-related deaths so far in Portugal alone. Another danger, fire. Flames from a grass fire consumed homes in a suburb of London. In France, 39,000 people have been forced to evacuate as firefighters struggle to put out wildfires in shifting winds. In Spain, wildfires have spread frighteningly close to railways. This video was captured by a passenger. Europe has been experiencing more excessive heat waves in recent years, evidence, experts say, of climate change. The high temperatures are coupled with a lack of water. The Rhine River, a key artery for shipping in Europe, is at its lowest level in 15 years. In Italy, the dry heat has turned swamps and marshes into hard, cracked land. UN officials say these unprecedented temperatures should be a wake-up call for government action.
In the future, these kind of heat waves are going to be normal, and we will see even stronger extremes.
For now, forecasters say the heat will only continue to get worse, possibly not subsiding until the middle of next week.
In the U.S., heat alerts will affect nearly one-third of the nation through tomorrow. A fire broke out at Hoover Dam on the Nevada-Arizona border today after a transformer burst into flames. The fire was extinguished quickly and no injuries were reported. The Bureau of Reclamation is currently investigating the cause of the fire and said there is not a risk to the power grid. In Ukraine, Russian forces kept up a fearsome barrage targeting cities in the south and east and killing scores of civilians. The attacks came as Moscow declared that peace would come only on its terms. In the port city of Odessa, firefighters scrambled to douse flames ignited by shelling overnight. Ukrainian officials said Russia's long-distance assault has escalated as its ground campaign has stalled. Russian President Vladimir Putin arrived in Iran amid U.S. warnings he wants to buy military drones to use in Ukraine. Putin met with Iran's president and its supreme leader, Ayatollah Khamenei. State TV quoted Khamenei as warning against, quote, Western deception. Putin met separately with Turkey's President Erdogan, also in Tehran. The World Health Organization is out with a new warning about super infectious COVID subvariants. The agency says cases in Europe have tripled in the past 6 weeks and hospitalization rates have doubled. In Belgium today, the WHO's European director said the new outbreaks will get worse in the fall and winter.
The virus has never gone away. People sometimes ask, is the virus back? It has never gone away. It's still there. It's spreading. It is mutating. And unfortunately, it's still taking a lot of lives. Last week alone, in our region, 3,000 people sadly passed away.
Also today, the U.S. Centers for Disease Control recommended a COVID-19 vaccine from Novavax for everyone over the age of 18. This is the fourth vaccine approved for use in the United States. A federal jury in Washington heard opening statements today in Steve Bannon's trial for contempt of Congress. Prosecutors said the former Trump advisor decided he was above the law when he defied a subpoena by the January 6th committee. He has pleaded innocent to two misdemeanor counts. The National Archives is asking the Secret Service to investigate deletions of January 6th text messages. In a letter today to the House committee investigating the attack on the Capitol, the Secret Service acknowledged deleting the text despite requests from Congress and federal investigators that they be preserved. The agency has denied any malicious intent. It says the data was lost during a long-planned update of mobile devices. The U.S. House of Representatives today approved federal protections for same-sex and interracial marriages. Advocates for marriage equality have raised concern that the Supreme Court's overturning of Roe v. Wade could affect other rights. 47 Republicans joined all Democrats in support of the Respect for Marriage Act. The debate largely focused on whether any legislative action is needed.
Today, the Democrats bring forward a bill that is completely unnecessary. Why are the Democrats going down this path? Because, frankly, they have nothing else.
To Mr. Jordan's suggestion that this is not necessary, tell it to the millions of LGBTQ families that are worried about the Supreme Court's intention to rip away more freedom.
The House plans to vote later this week on safeguarding access to contraception. All of the bills face uncertain prospects in the evenly divided Senate. Still to come on the NewsHour, the Biden administration faces criticism for not advocating more for human rights abroad. A new book chronicles the U.S. war against ISIS with some surprising new details. A new program aims to build a more inclusive future in the male-dominated world of jazz and much more.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
The Senate today moved forward on legislation that aims to boost semiconductor production here in the U.S. It comes as chip shortage is impacting the everyday lives of Americans. Lisa Desjardins has that story.
Omna, refrigerators, microwaves, computers, mobile phones, cars, military-grade weapons are all things that require semiconductors or chips to function. The bill making its way through Congress includes at least $52 billion in grants and incentives to design and manufacture chips and a 25% tax credit to help build high-tech facilities. The size of the bill could also grow in the next day. Even so, this legislation is a scaled-down version of a larger bill aimed at boosting U.S. competitiveness with China. For more on this, I'm joined by Secretary of Commerce Gina Raimondo. Thank you for joining us. There's a fascinating legislative story to this. I know you've been up and back on the Hill many times to try and get this to this point. But let me just ask you the big question. Why is this an important bill? Why is this the priority?
Thank you, Lisa. Well, as you just said, every piece of modern medical equipment, every piece of military equipment, everything that needs a computer or that is digital runs on chips. And the reality is we don't make very many chips in the United States of America. In fact, alarmingly, for the most sophisticated chips, we buy almost all of them from Taiwan. We're incredibly dependent on Asia and Asian countries for our supply of chips, including those that are necessary in all of our military equipment. And so the United States is at a risk, and we need to make more of these on our shores in the United States so that we can not only create jobs, but also protect our people.
You know, I haven't heard anyone disagree with that, with this idea that there's a need, but some folks say there's other needs as well. And we're talking about $50 billion, upwards of that. That's money that could go to perhaps freezing student loans for a year or needs for the pandemic and disease. Why is this more important than those other things our country needs now?
Yeah. Well, first of all, I agree with President Biden that we ought to be able to do all of that. But I'm not sure it's an either or. But here's what I would say about this. This is a core national security imperative. Right now, as I said before, we buy all of these chips of a certain kind from Taiwan. We are heavily dependent on China and Taiwan. We don't make this stuff in America. And yet it is what we need in military equipment, in pacemakers, in the hospital, in cars. You saw in Lansing, I think GM had to close a facility for a week and put people out of work because they ran out of chips. We just can't do that. We just can't allow ourselves to be overly reliant on these countries in Asia to defend our country. So this is a core national security objective, which will create, you know, by the way, hundreds of thousands of good, high-paying manufacturing jobs in the United States of America. So it has to happen. It has to happen now. It's just common sense. It is just common sense that we make this investment so we make chips in America, create jobs, and secure our national security.
I want to give you a chance to respond to also some criticism that came from the Wall Street Journal specifically. We know that the U.S. has been less of a world supplier of these chips over the past. That's what we're trying to correct here. But the Wall Street Journal says there's some other statistics not mentioned, is that the U.S. leads in chip design already, more than 50% of the world, 52% of world supply on that, chip making equipment, and that 7 of the world's 10 largest semiconductor companies are based in the U.S. So given that, and given that some Democrats have said they see this as a corporate giveaway. You mentioned the urgency. Why is it so urgent at this moment?
So it's so urgent at this moment because these companies have a choice. And it is true, many of them are American companies, but American companies operate all over the world. And they have a choice as to where to operate. And every other country recently, Germany, France, Singapore, Japan, are offering incentives to those companies to expand in those countries. And so there is no question that these companies will expand and will add jobs and add production. The only question is whether they will do it in the United States of America on American soil, which is what we need for our national security, or whether they will do it in another country. And so this is about having these jobs and this secure supply in our country so that when we need it, we have it.
Some in the manufacturing community, the semiconductor community, are saying that too much of this bill would help one company, Intel. How do you respond to that?
Absolutely not true. Absolutely not true. It remains to be seen who will receive these incentives. And it's really any company willing to make a big commitment to invest in the United States to produce chips is eligible for the incentives, and there'll be an open, transparent, competitive process. And, you know, everybody ought to apply who's qualified.
You come from having run a state, Rhode Island. Now you're having to deal with Congress. And Congress doesn't really operate well on deadlines. So when you say this is needed now, you mean in the next few weeks, right? Are these companies making decisions now about where to give these jobs? Can you help explain that?
Yes, I literally mean in the next couple of weeks. You know, Intel, which is a big semiconductor company, is entertaining offers from Italy and Spain and Germany. They have to make the decision this summer because they have to start the expansion now. Other companies, it's the same thing. There's an explosion of demand for chips, and these companies are under a lot of pressure from their customers to hurry up and expand so they can fulfill the orders. I would say tonight, perhaps while we're talking, the Senate is poised to take the first of several votes to take action on this. And I think it's time for Congress to act and get this to the president's desk in the next couple of weeks.
You know, I'm a national debt nerd. So one thing I've noticed about this bill is it isn't paid for. This would be adding to the deficit. Why is it worth adding to our loan, in fact, including loans from China, in order to boost our competitiveness with China?
Because this is about national security. We can't put a price on our national security. Right now, the United States is denying semiconductors to Russia. And as a result, their satellites and military equipment are literally falling out of the sky because they don't have semiconductors. That could be us. If Taiwan or China decided not to supply the United States chips, that would be us. We wouldn't be able to defend ourselves. So I think $52 billion is really a drop in the bucket, so that we can, you know, have peace of mind and national security.
One final big picture economic question, inflation, obviously a concern of every American, big concern on Capitol Hill. How do you answer those? Maybe some on the Hill who are asking you, this administration didn't get it right on inflation. It's worse than we thought it was. Why should we trust you in other areas like this?
Look, inflation's a global problem. You know, we were chatting before we came on about Europe. Europe's seeing much higher inflation than we are in certain countries. It's double digit. This is a global problem driven largely by the pandemic, by Putin's war. And the Fed has taken strong action. Our administration, the president's administration, is doing everything we know how to do to bring down inflation. So I think this is apples and oranges. What we're talking about here is getting behind a bipartisan bill to increase domestic productions of a critical technology to secure our future. Separately, inflation, which, as I say, is a global issue, and we are going to get that under control.
Commerce Secretary Gina Raimondo, we know you've been working on this for a long time. Thank you for talking with us about it.
Thank you.
A new report from the Centers for Disease Control finds U.S. overdose deaths rose significantly for people of color between 2019 and 2020. As John Yang reports, the CDC says the synthetic opioid fentanyl is largely to blame, combined with other disruptions to treatment and prevention during the pandemic.
Anna, while overall overdose deaths spiked by 30% during that period, among Black Americans, the increase was 44%. Among Native Americans and Alaska Natives, 39%. That's compared with a 22% increase among white Americans, similar to the rates among Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders and Hispanics. Dr. Edwin Chapman is a physician in Washington, D.C., who specializes in treating addiction. Dr. Chapman, thanks for being with us. We've heard the aggregate numbers. How does that track with what you see in your clinic?
Very close to what we're seeing here. In Washington, D.C., we saw a 40% increase in overdose deaths between 2019 and 2020, and then we saw another 4 or 5% increase between 20 and 21. So our overall increase since 2019 has been about 50% in the District of Columbia. So those numbers are very close.
And in your practice, what's driving those numbers? What's driving that increase?
So we've known for some time that our population, which is 95% African-American, even though in terms of overdose deaths, even though in the District of Columbia, we account for only 46% of the population. But the difference is that our epidemic started with street drugs 40, 50, 60 years ago with heroin. But in 2014, that heroin transitioned to fentanyl. So we saw 20% fentanyl in 2015, and it gradually increased over the next 5 years till now we're seeing 95% fentanyl in our street drugs. And fentanyl is 50 to 100 times more potent than morphine.
And I just want to make sure I'm clear on this. Is this that the drug users are seeking out fentanyl, or that the fentanyl is mixed into the street drugs?
Well, it goes both ways. Initially, it was mixed in, and subsequently, there were those who did seek out the more potent form. But unfortunately, with fentanyl being so much stronger than heroin or the typical pills that people were overdosing and dying. So we're actually seeing a Darwinian evolution, so to speak. Those who are able to tolerate higher doses of drugs just by their genetics and by luck are surviving, and those are the ones that we're seeing in treatment.
Dr. Chapman, are you seeing any other changes in the patients that you're seeing? Is the age, for instance, of your average patient changing?
Absolutely. So 5 years ago, we did a survey, and the average age of our patients was about 52, 70% male, 30% female. We actually, because it's an older population, 10 to 12% were testing positive for HIV, and about 50% were testing positive for hepatitis C. So since that time, the age has increased to an average age of about 60 at the present time.
And what effect does that have on overdose deaths and treatment?
So again, you're now talking about people who have other chronic diseases, diabetes, hypertension, as well mixed in with their opioid use and of course some of their mental health issues.
Is there, in this sort of racial disparity in the increase, does the access to treatment play a role in this?
Oh, absolutely. Just by structure, African-American physicians are only 5%. And then when you look at psychologists, only 4%, psychiatrists, 2%. So we're dealing with those structural issues. And on top of those structural issues, we also have some public policy issues that have to be addressed.
And has the disparity, the widening inequality that we've seen during the pandemic, has that had an effect?
Yes, so all of this is really, when we look at it as a whole, we can say that the pandemic really is acting as a barometer for our overall healthcare system. We can see these structural and public policy issues that have gone for centuries, in fact, coming to the forefront. And they're exacerbated by housing issues, transportation issues. So our patient population, because they've been involved in drug use for so many years, are disenfranchised from the community, disenfranchised from families. So we have a very high homeless population.
What are the changes you'd like to see that would help you treat your patients?
So our approach has been really to a team-based approach. And we realize that 80% of the outcomes are related to things outside of the doctor's office, outside of the hospital. So we really need to have this community education. We need to have advocacy in the community, legal support, to oversee, to make sure that patients are getting the type of treatment that they need. And of course, we need to integrate substance abuse, mental health, and primary care services, because these patients have the same issues as everyone else. The fact is that they've had so many difficulties, including their involvement with the criminal justice system, that have to be reversed.
Addiction specialist Dr. Edwin Chapman, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well, today, the family of Jamal Khashoggi, the Saudi journalist murdered in Saudi Arabia's Istanbul consulate, wrote to President Biden asking him to intervene in the detention of one of Khashoggi's lawyers. The United Arab Emirates sentenced that lawyer to 3 years in prison the same day President Biden met with that country's president. It raises the question of what President Biden got out of his Middle East trip and of the balance between human rights and pragmatic foreign policy. Nick Schifrin delves into that debate.
A meeting with a leader of what critics call a brutal regime. A fist bump with a crown prince accused of persecuting and approving the murder of his enemies.
It's really good to see you again, Sheikh Mohammed.
And warm greeting for the president of a country the State Department says arbitrarily arrests and tortures detainees. Or rewind. A meeting with a leader at the center of a changing region. Greetings with a 36-year-old who helps control oil and will be a regional power broker for decades. And a conversation with a president helping integrate the region with Israel. The debate between an idealistic and realistic foreign policy is not new.
I know it's late, but thank you for being here.
But it's one President Biden faced head-on this trip, saying he could juggle both. The U.S. and Saudi Arabia talked about a half dozen topics, and President Biden said he confronted Saudi Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman about the U.S. intelligence conclusion that Salman approved the 2018 murder of journalist Jamal Khashoggi in Saudi Arabia's Istanbul consulate.
He basically said that he was not personally responsible for it. I indicated I thought he was. This trip is about, once again, positioning America in this region for the future.
I'm very disappointed, honestly, in this trip.
Sanaa Saif is an Egyptian filmmaker and activist. Her brother, Ala Abd El Fattah, is one of Egypt's most prominent political prisoners. He's been on a hunger strike now for 109 days. Sanaa has been arrested three times in the last 9 years, since President Abd El Fattah al-Sisi and the military seized power.
Why did President Biden grant him that handshake without conditioning any human rights concessions, even forcing Sisi to at least pretend to care about human rights?
How's your brother doing?
Ala is slowly dying, but he's trying to slow down his death as much as possible because he's fighting this for his life, right? Sisi has managed to oppress the society in all sectors. Like, human rights defenders are in prison. Just normal females who, like, make TikTok videos wearing some revealing clothes are in prison. Political opposition from Islamist background are in prison. In a nutshell, Egypt is deeply unstable, and this is just a plain, you know, authoritarian regime.
The president says that while dealing with President Sisi and other regional leaders, he does bring up human rights. What policy would you rather see President Biden pursue?
Bringing up human rights confidentially, secretly, is something, and being vocal about human rights is another thing. The Egyptian regime understands very well that when Western governments are only bringing up human rights in private diplomacy, that they don't have to interpret this seriously.
It was important for the president to travel to the Gulf to really reset the relationships, turn the page, if you will.
Gerald Feierstein is the former U.S. ambassador to Yemen and a distinguished fellow at the Middle East Institute.
We continue to look to the region as a prime source of energy. And that's going to continue for many years into the future.
Why is it important for President Biden to have met not only with Saudi leaders, but also leaders including President Sisi of Egypt?
If part of the objective of the president's travel to the region was to expand the scope of regional defense and security integration, to include Israel in the architecture, then having Egypt participate in those conversations, having Jordan participate in those conversations is also going to be important.
President Biden vowed to put human rights at the center of his foreign policy. Has he gone against his vow by fist bumping or shaking hands with regional leaders who have bad records on human rights?
I think that the president was very clear that it's going to continue to be an aspect of U.S. foreign policy, but it can't be the only issue that the United States bases its policies on. We don't have the opportunity or the luxury of only looking at at our foreign relations through that single aperture.
The administration simultaneously blocked $130 million in military aid to Egypt over human rights concerns, but approved $2 billion worth of military cargo planes and radars. Sanaa Saif says the policy debate is not either or.
The relationship between Egypt and the U.S. is so strong that if at the aesthetics level the administration raises human rights, it will have a positive effect on our situation inside without really undermining the relationships.
The debate will continue even if President Biden wants to move on. Asked whether he regrets the Crown Prince fist bump.
Why don't you guys talk about something that matters?
But there's no escaping those questions when the U.S. calls these countries and these leaders allies and partners. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Nick Schifrin.
Protesters once again demonstrated in front of the U.S. Supreme Court today over abortion, 3 weeks after the justices overturned Roe v. Wade. 17 members of Congress were among those arrested during the protest this afternoon after U.S. Capitol Police said they blocked traffic outside the court. Since the court's ruling last month, doctors in states with abortion bans have struggled to figure out how to care for patients with high-risk pregnancies, including miscarriages. The Department of Health and Human Services put out new guidance last week saying any state ban is preempted by federal law, protecting abortions as part of emergency care. But medical providers are still concerned they could be prosecuted for performing some procedures. Joining me now is Dr. David Hackney. He is a maternal-fetal medicine specialist based in Ohio. Dr. Hackney, welcome to the NewsHour. I think it's fair to say the last few weeks have made clear there are a number of doctors who are confused or scared about what they can or can't do in this new reality we are when they're caring for pregnant patients. That federal guidance I just laid out, is that clear to you? Do you have a clear understanding of what you can and cannot do?
It does help, and we certainly appreciate everything that the department is doing in that regard. However, it doesn't solve many of the problems that we have, which are specific to the state which we're in now. Unfortunately, some things are very clear in the state of Ohio. We cannot perform abortions for fetal genetic anomalies, fetal birth defects, even those in which we know that the child would not survive. And we also cannot perform abortions solely because the pregnancy was conceived by rape. That is very straightforward, in my opinion. That is very, very tragic. The other main category in which we sometimes get involved in abortion care is cases in which it's needed to either save the mother's life or on behalf of the mother's health. And this is where there's still a lot of things which are not clear. In Ohio, the law does call out some specific cases. So if there's pre-viable premature membranes breaking the bag of water, or if mom has preeclampsia, that is spelled out. But a lot of things are very much less clear, and there's a lot of fear among OBGYNs who don't know when we could proceed on behalf of mother's health or not.
So what does that mean for your patients? I mean, if you have a pregnant patient come in today, you detect a lethal anomaly, what do you say to your patient? What kind of care can you provide?
What I try to do first is I try to talk to them as if the law hasn't changed and try to come up with them with what would work the best for them. You know, there are patients who are diagnosed with lethal birth defects who do choose to continue to move forward. And we do certainly always support those patients if that's what works best for them. So what my own approach has been the last couple of weeks is I just try to talk to the patient. I say, pretend that the laws didn't change and let's figure out first what would work best for you. Unfortunately, for most patients in the setting of a lethal birth defect, they choose not to move forward. And this is where I now have to tell the patient that they cannot receive an abortion in the state. We are still allowed to speak freely. We are still allowed to refer out of state. So, you know, we will start to try to do that. But there is the potential for a patient with a lethal birth defect who will not be able to leave the state of Ohio and would be forced to continue to term against their will, which I just cannot imagine what a nightmare that would be.
What's the risk for that patient in a situation like that?
Well, even if the patient is completely healthy, so sometimes we have a case where all of the concerns are fetal, mom is in totally good health, just even a completely normal, healthy pregnancy always carries risks. And the risk of the pregnancy which continues to term is always greater than the risk of an abortion procedure in the first trimester or even the second too. You know, in high-risk obstetrics all the time, we see completely healthy patients where everything is going well, and then they go to deliver, and there's hemorrhage or a blood clot in the lung. And we know that things along those lines can occur. I can't imagine if there was a patient who had a lethal fetal disorder, was forced to continue the pregnancy to term against their will, and then had something terrible happen when they went to deliver. That would just be a tragedy with no benefits at all.
Dr. Hackney, let me ask you about this new landscape we're in, because it's clear that there are legal voices watching. We've seen attorney generals weigh in on some of these cases. Attorney General in your neighboring state of Indiana even threatened to go after a doctor who did provide a legal abortion service in one case. I'm curious what it feels like to try to do your job in this climate, what you're feeling and experiencing, what other doctors are telling you they're worried about.
There is a lot of fear. I myself was on call the very first night that the law changed. You know, I got a text from friends on a Friday night saying that it had gone into effect. And I do high-risk obstetrics. I was going to be rounding in the hospital Saturday and Sunday, and I didn't know what to do. You know, what if I came in Saturday and there was a patient who was bleeding or someone who was going into heart failure? And there's still a lot of gray zones where we're not exactly sure what the best thing is to do.
You know, it sounds, Dr. Hackney, like there's a lot you don't know. I've heard you say uncertain a lot of times. We're in a new legal landscape. And one, I should mention, you have argued against. So what is it that you want to see from state leaders or from federal leaders that you think would help you to better care for and protect your patients?
Well, the biggest thing I would want to see is for the Ohio State Supreme Court to stop this law, to stop SB 23. You know, we're talking about rape children. We are talking about pregnancies where there's a lethal birth defect, and the woman tragically is going to be forced to continue against her will. The Ohio Supreme Court has the potential power to stop this law. The issue of children at the moment, you know, is very, very unclear. The Attorney General should say clearly, you know, which children who have been raped can provide abortion care and which one we cannot. I mean, it's such a horrible topic. You know, I don't believe to some extent that we're having to think about this. And this shouldn't have to come from me. You know, as the chair of OBGYN for the state, you know, I'm getting a lot of calls. I'm getting a lot of questions. I'm trying to figure this out. I'm looking over the research and data on when do you have physical damage to the body of a raped child. This whole scenario, I have to say, it's unfair.
That is Dr. David Hackney, a maternal fetal medicine specialist based in Ohio, joining us tonight. Dr. Hackney, thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Well, 5 years ago this month, the Iraqis declared victory over the Islamic State, or ISIS, in the battle for the city of Mosul. That marked a major turning point in the war against ISIS militants across the region. In the earlier American war in Iraq, the U.S. committed large numbers of ground forces and did the bulk of the fighting. But in the war against the Islamic State, Iraqi forces led the way, with the United States providing only limited military support and advising. Nick Schifrin is back now with a conversation about a new book that looks at the U.S. role in battling extremism in Iraq.
When the Obama administration withdrew U.S. forces from Iraq in 2011, it declared it was turning the tide of war. But by 2014, the group that called itself the Islamic State seized territory across Iraq and Syria the size of Belgium. Reluctantly, the U.S. went to war again, this time with a different approach than previous invasions, using proxy forces, a small number of U.S. trainers, and vast amounts of air power. That's the story told in Degrade and Destroy, the inside story of the war against the Islamic State, from Barack Obama to Donald Trump. The author is Wall Street Journal reporter Michael Gordon, who joins me now. Michael, welcome back to the
News. Thank you.
Thanks very much. You write that this book isn't just about the past. It's a window into the future because it will reveal the methods that the U.S. will use again. Why is that?
Well, I think after several wars in the Middle East, Afghanistan, Desert Storm, there's not much appetite on the part of American public to send tens of thousands of troops back into the Middle East, nor is there interest on the part of policymakers. They're focusing now on China, on Russia. Those are the main threats driving Pentagon strategy. But the threats aren't going to go away. So the concept of using a small number of advisors, coupling them with a proxy force, partners on the ground, and accessing air power and reconnaissance is likely to be a template that the U.S. is going to use again in the Middle East, ungoverned spaces, and even in some great power scenarios like we're seeing in Ukraine.
Before that template was created, you write that the Obama administration, in the early days of ISIS's emergence, misunderstood the evolution of the Islamic State. President Obama, of course, famously called it the JV team at one point. What was the impact of that misunderstanding?
Well, it left the U.S. unprepared for what it later had to do. You know, the very month that President Obama called ISIS the JV team was the same month that the head of the Delta Force and the senior special operations commander for the Middle East went to Iraq, saw Iraq's counterterrorism service in action, and reported up their chain that it was overmatched, that it was having a hard time coping with this ISIS, which was really an evolution from an al-Qaeda in Iraq group.
What was overmatched, of course, was the Iraqi military at the time, and you describe it as rudimentary, what one soldier referred to as a Valley Forge scenario, of course, a reference to the American Revolutionary Army at its lowest point. Why had the Iraqi military deteriorated to that point by 2014?
In 2011, 2010, when the U.S. still had forces in Iraq, it was very well understood on the part of the Iraqi generals and the American generals that there was a continuing need for a small American presence to mentor, train, enable Iraqi forces. But the politics in Baghdad and the politics in Washington were such that American forces left at the end of 2011. They were unable to reach a diplomatic agreement that would allow them to stay. As a consequence of that, the U.S. was not monitoring the deterioration of the Iraqi forces. And also, they weren't able to really check the worst sectarian impulses of the Iraqi prime minister at the time, Nouri al-Maliki, who not only put in his sort of cronies, but took actions that alienated the Sunnis in his country and provided a fertile ground for ISIS to gain a hold in the countryside.
And so by the time the ISIS gained a hold in the countryside, we're in 2014, and the plan that the U.S. created in September 2014 uses local forces to take the lead. How important, looking back, is choosing the right partner in that fight? And in general, how different was that approach to what had preceded it?
What was really extraordinary about this particular campaign, and I was in a lot of it in Mosul and in Syria and saw a lot of it firsthand, is that there was no one partner. There were a multitude of partners. There were partners who didn't even get along with each other and wouldn't have even dealt with each other if the U.S. hadn't been there as a kind of a glue to hold it together. And what President Obama was determined to do is he didn't want to send American troops back into ground combat. Now, there were some instances we were in ground combat. I have them in the book. But in the main, it was the local forces who were in ground combat. But they were to be advised by small teams of Americans.
One of the forces fighting on the same side against ISIS were actually Iranian forces. And you're the first to report that an American Marine general encountered Iranian Quds Force Commander Qasem Soleimani, who, of course, would later be killed during the Trump administration. What does their meeting in Iraq say about the fight against ISIS?
In the very first years of the war, Americans and Iranians were on the same battlefield, but they weren't fighting each other, and they weren't trying to kill each other. It's a different situation now. And they were basically trying to stay out of each other's way. What happened in that instance was pretty extraordinary. An Iraqi general led Qasem Soleimani into a command post at Union 3, which is across the street from the American embassy. And General Castelvi, who was the Marine general then, was rather surprised to come face to face with the Quds Force commander. They had a discussion. It wasn't about cooperation. It was more about the situation on the battlefield and where forces were because they were in a deconfliction mode. But over time, as the war, it was clear the U.S. was going to win this war, which it did win. The Iranians became more assertive and became more of a threat to Americans. And ironically, Qasem Soleimani was later killed by an American drone just a few miles from where that event took place at the Baghdad International Airport.
You reveal for the first time the U.S. has been reviewing in advance Israeli airstrikes in Syria that have been going on for years. There have been 400 of those strikes since 2017. What is that review and why is that important?
Well, Syria is a very crowded place now. It's sort of the strategic equivalent of the Star Wars bar. You have Turkey threatening to intervene still. You have the Russians very active in there and actually quite successful in intervening in that country at minimal cost to themselves. You have the Iranians in there. You have Shiite militias in there. You have Americans in there, about 1,000 in eastern Syria in the Antaf garrison. And you have the Israelis taking action in the form of airstrikes against the Iranians and arms shipments the Iranians are trying to send to Lebanese Hezbollah to make their weapons more accurate. So it's all mixed up. And in this environment, Israel has a deconfliction arrangement with the Russians. They tell them they're coming, but they have a much more formal process with U.S. Central Command. It's intended basically to let the Americans know if they're going into eastern Syria, this is what's going to happen because there are American troops there and they might have to suffer the consequences in the form of Iranian retaliation. The Americans have vetoed a few of those strikes, but in the main, they don't interfere.
Michael Gordon, the book is Degrade and Destroy, the Inside Story of the War Against the Islamic State from Barack Obama to Donald Trump. Michael Gordon, thank you very much.
Thank you.
When most people think of jazz greats, few faces of women and non-binary musicians likely come to mind. But a new program is working to change that. Jeffrey Brown takes a look at a pipeline being developed to pump talent into clubs and onto stages across the country and the world. It's part of our arts and culture series, Canvas.
A recent jazz performance at the Kennedy Center's Millennium Stage in Washington, D.C. 28-year-old pianist Anastasia Petrova says she came to love jazz as a girl in Kazakhstan when she heard a teacher play a ballad by Bill Evans.
I loved it from the first seconds. I decided for myself, I want to have a piece of that freedom.
You use the word freedom, you want, what does that mean?
Freedom under his fingers. He didn't have any sheet music in front of him, he was just playing out of his head, and I couldn't believe that this is possible.
30-year-old Ivana Cuesta Gonzalez grew up listening to music with her father in the Dominican Republic. Then one day came across a drum set in church.
I saw the drums and no one could play it, so I was like, I can do it. So, you know, they just pay me like 2 classes, learn the first rhythm and the first feel, and that's it. And that was just like the beginning, I would say.
Years later, for these early to mid-career professionals, the love is still there. But while the road to making a life in jazz is hard for anyone, some face lingering cultural and other barriers.
I approached stage and a male musician immediately asked me, are you going to dance today or sing? So that immediately diminished my skills as a pianist, and if I don't have someone introducing me to the band, to the house band, there is no way I could join a jam session.
31-year-old Swedish-born guitarist Loki Riesberg identifies as a trans man.
You get a feeling, or sometimes people say it out loud, like, oh, can you really, can you, like, they question you and...
I mean, can you really play?
Yeah, and in a way you wouldn't question someone who's a cisgender male. And that sort of puts it in my head that can I really? And like that's the worst thing I think you should have in your mind when you go up to play a concert or a jam session.
These musicians are now part of a new program focused on women and non-binary jazz artists, started by veteran drummer Terry Lynn Carrington.
Your average musician, or how I actually really like to say it is, your marginal male musician will be supported and have work opportunities more than a woman that actually excels because of the culture and all of the stereotypes that she has to face before she even plays a note.
Carrington, who was performing with her band, Social Science, in one of the Kennedy Center's main theaters that night, is a three-time Grammy-winning drummer, composer, and producer, who's played and worked with legends, including Woody Shaw, Stan Getz, Herbie Hancock, and a long list of others. She comes from a musical family. Her father, Matt Carrington, a saxophone player in Boston, introduced his young daughter to the art form and many of its leading practitioners. She played her first professional gig at age 10 and hasn't stopped. She's also a noted educator, teaching at the Berklee College of Music in Boston, where we met recently. She says she used to advise young women to just put their heads down and push past the barriers, but no more.
Because everybody doesn't have the same personality. Everybody doesn't have the same confidence. Everybody doesn't have the same support. Everybody doesn't have the same access that I had.
At Berklee, Carrington heads the Institute of Jazz and Gender Justice and has now created the Next Jazz Legacy Program.
What I tried to do is think about what helped me to develop as a musician. What were the most important things? And it was really the musicians that gave me a shot, even before I was ready. And I think that those opportunities are more far and few between it for women than they are for men.
One statistic, in a 2019 NPR Jazz Critics list of top 50 albums, almost 60% had no women at all in the lineup of instrumentalists. A similar proportion of all jazz albums had no women musicians at all.
We know there are some fantastic female vocalists who've become very famous and very successful in jazz, but there's a particular problem with instrumentalists and improvisers who, you know, that's the backbone of that community.
Next Jazz Legacy was co-launched by the advocacy group New Music USA, headed by Vanessa Reed.
It's about ensuring that women and non-binary instrumentalists can see that they have role models that they can follow, but also it's about building alliances with men, because if we don't work with the people who currently have the most power in jazz, then we're never going to affect change.
The emphasis here is on apprenticeships, band leaders offering year-long hands-on work, and mentorships.
I found myself holding it like this, signifying the freedom.
In which participants, seven in the first cohort, are matched with more experienced musicians. Here, Kalia Vandeveer worked with Jen Hsu recently in a New York City park.
You're going to do your own thing as well.
They also receive guidance on the business end of the jazz industry and a $10,000 stipend. Some top talent has signed on to help. Ivana Cuesta Gonzalez is now working with Esperanza Spalding, one woman who has broken through to stardom in recent years. And she'll soon work with sax player Wayne Shorter, a long-established giant in the field.
I mean, this is like kind of a dream for me,
yeah,
being with both.
And what is it you hope to get from them?
For me, it's like to see how authentic they are. And I actually want to be like that, you know, don't be afraid of my own ideas and like try to put it there. And if people accept that, it's fine. If not, it's fine too. Mm-hmm. So I think both, in a way, they have been doing that in their own generation.
The world of jazz is changing, Terry Lynn Carrington says, just not fast enough. This program, she hopes, will help individuals, but also impact the sound of jazz itself.
I never looked at, well, I'm a woman, what does that mean in this music? What does that sound like? Does it have a sound? I never looked at that because I was always trying to imitate men playing the music because that's all we ever heard. We've yet to see that happen because there's not enough of us yet that are that people are trying to imitate.
Stay tuned then for that next Jazz 2. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jeffrey Brown at the Berklee College of Music in Boston.
Beautiful note to end our show on. That is the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Amna Nawaz. Join us online and again back here tomorrow evening. For all of us at the PBS NewsHour, thank you for joining us, and we'll see you soon.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
Architect, Beekeeper, Mentor, a Raymond James financial advisor tailors advice to help you live your life. Life well planned.
Carnegie Corporation of New York, supporting innovations in education, democratic engagement, and the advancement of international peace and security at carnegie.org. The Target Foundation, committed to advancing racial equity and creating the change required to shift systems and accelerate equitable economic opportunity. And with the ongoing support of these institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you. This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
You're watching PBS.